It's an absolute honour to have you here with us at FrightFest. Can you tell us how you first got involved in the project?
It was through some mutual friends. Said a guy called Ben had this script knocking around called The Chamber. It's so, there's no exciting story behind it. And asked if he could tell me the script. I read it. And I'd been asked to do a few things before. And I suppose I just, because it's all new to me, I always had one rule. If I read the script in a first sitting, then it meant that, I enjoyed it. And so I got the script off Ben and just read it in one sitting flat. Met up with him. We had really got on. I had the same kind of had the same references. Really just got on. And I thought, well, it's the first time I've actually been asked to do something where I read the script and I just want to keep turning the page. Really got on the director. Hell, it's, at the age of 40, I'm 47 now, but at the age of 46, let's take a chance on something. And I'm really glad I did.
Obviously, you're excited by the script. Can you talk about the musical influences that went into the music you provide?
Yeah, I don't want to try and extemporize around quite simple technical issues. But, the one thing you're aware of when you read a script which is based in a submersible in the ocean is that you have the sonic irony of having a very close environment stuck within a vast environment. You have this submersible, trapped at the bottom of a vast, endless ocean. So you've got to try and achieve, I suppose what I tried to achieve was, I wanted all the echoes, the noises, all the the ephemera of noise that's associated with the submarine. I wanted those noises to feel as if they were being choked, that they wanted to escape, but they were hitting a first wall beyond the ocean. I think that's your first challenge, to try and convey that close space, which is like a Russian doll. It's trapped in a vast space. So, that was the first challenge, I think.
Is there one score in particular that really means a lot to you and really inspires you?
I suppose you always go back to the things that you loved when you were young, very young. Myself, Nicky, Sean and Richie and the Manics, we're all massive film heads when we're young. I think I remember the first two soundtracks I remember buying was the Birdie soundtrack, which Peter Gabriel did. And then it was the Rumblefish soundtrack, the Francis Ford Coppola film that was composed by Stuart Copeland from The Police. And because I loved those two films and I went and bought the soundtracks, they just stuck in my head. I loved the percussive nature of them. I love the fact that there weren't actually that many notes in the music. That the music was actually quite kinetic, quite physical. So if I had to choose two things, it would be the Birdie soundtrack by Peter Gabriel and Rumblefish soundtrack by Stuart Copeland. There was also one other record I loved when I was young, which was a Pretend soundtrack by a guitarist called Will Sargent from Echo and the Bunnymen. He had a little solo record called Themes from Grind, which was a Pretend soundtrack about quite a tawdry little character, which didn't have a film. And I loved that record too. So they're my touchstones, a bit of Iceland and New Barton, a German experimental group that use a lot of percussive elements in their music. That's it, I suppose, really. We've gone to Japan, playing a festival tomorrow, Victorious Festival in Portsmouth. And we've got two gigs in Japan, and then we're currently writing a new record. And we're just trying to excite ourselves, which sounds a bit suggestive, but that's our MO. We keep writing until we hit the spot, until we write songs that we just want to hear time and time again, and that's where we are at the moment.
Obviously fans love the material you've given us, and they have their favourite songs to hear when you're live. Is there one track in particular that you feel most proud of when you get the chance to perform it at these concerts?
I don't want to be disingenuous about this, but I tend not to think in terms of legacies or, what we've achieved, because I think that's the kind of mindset that you reserve for a politician. There are certain songs you fall back to, like Motorcycle Emptiness, Faster, Design for Life. Undoubtedly, you connect to those things because they connect to so many other people on a quite a visceral level. But I haven't got a league table of songs which I think represent us and what we've achieved and all that kind of rubbish. I don't think like that. We are certainly right, we've definitely weathered the storm in many different ways, but it's quite shocking, really. I have parents of young musicians come up to me all the time. I have young musicians come up to me asking for advice. And I always disappoint them because they say, when I got a record contract in 1991, everything, a major record label deal, we got that in 1991, I think. And I tell them that the industry I got my major record deal with was a completely different time. Everything has changed, absolutely everything. Whether it be record companies wanting artists to co-write with people all the time, whether you talk about artists getting syncs on adverts, that's one of the best ways of getting the breaks a band now. There's so much, the entire record industry has morphed and changed beyond any recognition as to what I recognized when I got my first record deal. So I can't give anybody any advice at all.